فيرست 3 about the speaker خالد إبراهيم محمد ماستر اوف ساينس اند اسيستنت ليكتشر ان جيوتكنيكال انجينيرنج اولسو اي ام ا سينيور جيوتكنيكال انجينير سم اوف اكاديميك اوف ماي اكاديميك اكسبيرينس ناو اي ام ا اسيستنت ليكتشر جيوتكنيكال انجينيرنج سيكشن فاكولتي اوف انجينيرنج فيوم يونيفرسيتي Also, I'm working as a head of geotechnical engineering section at Gilfar Consultancy Services with Ras Al Khaimah Municipality for United Arab Emirates, but in its office in Cairo. As a part-time, I am working as a senior geotechnical engineer with Active Brains Consultant Group at Doi, Giza, Egypt. Now I am a PhD candidate in geotechnical engineering, Faculty of Engineering, Fayoum University, Master of Science holder in geotechnical engineering. Also, I'm teaching the undergraduate students the subject related to soil mechanics and foundation engineering. For example, soil mechanics course for the third civil engineering student, soil improvement course for the final civil engineering student, and foundation engineering. I have two published paper extracted from my master thesis. Practical specialization, geotechnical investigation report, preparation and determine the geotechnical parameters from the results of the field and lab tests, different types of retaining structure, slope stability in soil, dewatering, reinforced retaining walls and slopes, shallow and deep foundation, curing system, etc., using many geotechnical software. For instance, Plex 2D, 3D, mechanical stabilized air sewer and RESA for Adama engineering software, Slide 2D for Rock Science Company and Geo5. Participating in projects related to geotechnics and geomechanics, preparation, many geotechnical investigation reports and quality control compaction reports in our soil mechanics and foundation lab at Faculty of Engineering, Fayoum University. Mechanical stabilized air sewer design for many compounds in North Coast in Egypt. For example, Sidi Hneish, Hassin Dawait, Hassin Dapay, Marasi, etc. Also, design of shoring system in Bahr al-Babkar water treatment station, one of the biggest water treatment stations in the Middle East, in Bor Said in Egypt. In the last 2 years, when I joined with the RAC municipality team, I have worked with the Tihad Railway project, one of the biggest projects in the Gulf area that will connect all Gulf countries to COSA. Review and geotechnical works from geotechnical investigation reports to drawing the and design reports for earthwork, slope stability, and mechanical stabilized air sewer. Objectives of this diploma. This diploma aims to improve the participants in slope stability for soils and rock. This course will provide the detailed knowledge related to the slope stability in soil and rock from initiating steps that cover the background basics of the soil and rock characterizations passing through passing through, just I choose the mouse to appear to the participants that cover the background basics of soil and rock characterizations, passing through understanding the importance of this geological process from the point of view and comprehensive disaster risk management. Through the 8 modules, the participants will learn estimating the design parameters of soils and rocks that will be used in the slope stability analysis. In addition, the method of slope stability analysis will be discussed during the diploma duration after theoretical and background principle covered using software that are used to analyze the slope stability in rock and soil. Finally, in the 18th module, in the last module of this diploma, the project thesis lines will be submitted to the students to make their thesis that will be evaluated. Introduction. Evaluating the stability of slopes in soil and rock is an important, interesting, and challenging aspect of civil engineering. Concerned with slope stability have driven some of the most important advances in our understanding of the complex behavior of soils. Extensive engineering and research study performed over the past 80 years provide a sound set of soil mechanics principle with which to attack practical problem of slope stability. There are a variety of engineering activities require excavation of rock cuts in civil engineering projects, include transportation system such as highways and railways, dams for power production and water supply and industrial and urban development. The design of rock cuts and their excavation and stability are closely related to site geological conditions that may vary from strong blocky rock containing well-defined discontinuities to weak, highly weathered rock in which the remnant discontinuities, if any, have little influence on stability. The syllabus of our diploma, the first module, we talked before that our diploma divided into 8 modules. The first module will talk about introduction and background of slope stability analysis in soil and rock. The second module, site investigation and geological data collection in soil and rock. The third module, rock strength probability, groundwater and their measurement. Module number 4, rock slopes failure types. Module number 5, numerical analysis and software applications in rock slope. From module number 6, we will move to the slope stability analysis in soils. Then in module number 7, rock and soil reinforcement stabilization methods. And module number 8, as I talked before, the thesis project that the student will submit, and we will evaluate this thesis. We will start to know the subsection in every module individually. Module number 1, introduction and background of slope stability analysis in soil and rock. We will talk about introduction slope stability in soil and rock, scope of studying slope stability in soil and rock, socioeconomic consequences of slope failure, example of slope failure in soil, causes of slope failure in soil, principles of rock slope engineering deformations, rock slope design method, and we will move to module number 2. Module number 2, its title is site investigation and geological data collection in soil and rock, and we will discuss in this module the following: planning an investigation program, site recognizance, geological mapping, spacing, resistance, and roughness measurements, probabilistics analysis of structural geology, and finally, investigation of weathered rock. Module number 3, rock strength probabilities, groundwater, and their measurement. And in this section, we will illustrate the following topics: shear strength of discontinuities, laboratory testing of shear strength of rock masses, by pack analysis of slope failure, Hoch-Brown strength criterion for fracture rock mass, shear strength of weathered rock mass, rock durability and compressive strength, groundwater flow in fractured rock, measurement of water pressure, field measurement of hydraulic conductivity. Then we will move to module number 4. In this module, we will talk about rock slopes failure types. There are 4 or 5 types, I think. The first type is planned failure, wedge failure, circular failure, and tumbling failure. Module number 5, numerical analysis and software applications in rock slope. And in this module, we will discuss the following items: overview of numerical models, modeling consideration, simple stability analysis software, application of the design and analysis of slope failure in rock. Then we will move to slope stability analysis in soil in module number 6. Total and effective stresses of soil, drained and undrained shear strength, basic requirement for slope stability analysis, stability condition for analysis cases for earth and rock fill dams, mechanics of limit equilibrium protruders, pore water pressure representation, slope stability analysis using limit equilibrium method and finite element method. Then in the module number 7, we will talk about rock and soil reinforcement stabilization. Number 1, rock stabilization by reinforcement, stabilization by rock removal, protection measures against rock falls, reinforced slope and embankments, case study on slope stability of soil and rock. And finally, in the module number 8, the thesis project, define the lines of the research project, review the preliminary thesis projects, and review the draft thesis submitted by the student. Now, we will move to talk in some details about some headlines for every module. The first module, introduction slopes in rocks. In the next two figures, this is the first figure you show, but the first figure divided into A and B. We show contrasting example of rock slope with respect to rock strength and structural geology. In the first figure, as you see in the figure number A, this is a concrete face. In the top of this concrete face, there's a cantilever wall, and the bottom part of this wall is anchored with anchor. As shown in the figure B, there are a plane, rock slope in very strong granite, in which upper blocks of rock can slide from right to left. This block can slide from right to left like this. And the angle of the block slide surface is 30 degrees. This site near Gaziz Bridge, Columbia in Canada, the site in Canada, and to prevent and avoid the slides of this block, we use concrete wool on the facing of the slope. The upper part is cantilever upper buttress, and the lower part we use rock bolts anchored in stable rock, and the length of this bolts driven inside the stable rock. This is a solution, concrete buttress and tie back anchors. Slope geometry showing dimension of slide blocks, bolts length and buttress configuration. This is the one case of the failure of the rock. Without using this concrete buttress with anchor, this rock will be sliding on this plan, and maybe a toppling failure occurred here. So we used one of the solution to prevent the instability of the rock slope. The other figure, this figure with the slope, excavated slope in weathered rock, highly weathered rock, as we show in the left photo number A. For a highway construction, this slope is 56 degrees. And to prevent this slope from failure, we used sawing nails with a shotcrete. This shotcrete thickness, I think 100 millimeter, and using a non-equal sawing nail. One of them is 6 meter and the other is 5 meter. And we use different, different length here. This is 7 meter or 6 meter and 5 meter to prevent local unique of global local. If we use the 5 meter, just 5 meter anchor nail, it's maybe a failure occur in this failure, in this slip failure. So the different, the using different length to prevent this criteria from occurred, okay? The required stability condition of rocks loop will vary depending on the type of the project and the consequences of failure. For example, for cuts above a highway carrying a high traffic volume, it will be important that both the overall slope be stable and that view if any rock falls reach the traffic lanes. That means that we shall prevent any failure from rock to this road, because this road will used and there are heavy traffic vehicles here, and we want to prevent any falls of rock in this highway. Okay, this will often require careful blasting during construction and the installation of stabilizing measures such as rock anchors, because the useful life of such stabilization measures may be only 10 to 30 years. Depending on the climate and rate of rock degradation, periodic maintenance may be required for long-term stability. The common design requirement for rock cut is to determine the maximum safe cut face angle compatible with the planned maximum height. There are two parameters that are very important in the analysis of the rock or soil slope stability. The first one is the maximum safe cut face angle, and the second one is the maximum height. The design process is a trade-off or a journey between stability and economics. We know the stability, and we need to reduce the cost of the cut or the cost of the stability of the slope that is steep. So the steep cuts are usually less expensive. It's normal when we use a very steep slope, we will not excavate more amount of soil or more amount of rock. So steep cuts are usually less expensive to construct than flat cuts, because the flat cuts we will excavate more amounts of rock or soil, because the volume of the excavated rock is minimized, less acquisition of right of way is required, and smaller cut face area created. However, with steep slope, when the angle of the face of the slope will be higher than 50, 60, it may be necessary to install extensive stabilizing measures. We need to stabilize this slope, such as rock bolts and chokecrete, in order to minimize both the risk of overall slope stability, instability, and rock falls during the operation life of the project. And this is very important. The operation life of the project is very important parameter, because if we need design any slope, any project related to slope stability, rock or soil, we need to know what is the time life of this project. As we increase the lifetime, as we need more accuracy and more safety for the project to maintain the stability during this lifetime of the project. In spite of the advances that have been made, evaluating the stability of slope remains a challenge, even when geology and soil condition have been evaluated in keeping with the standard of the good practice, and stability has been evaluated using procedures that have been effective in previous projects. It's possible that surprises are in store. What does that mean? In the slope stability, we can use the guidelines and code requirement, but the failure occurred. From our experience in projects and failures that happened, we shall learn and learn more from this experience, because some failure occurred even if we use the code requirements, because an additional load comes to the slope, like poor water pressure, like reduction in the strength of the soil materials with time in the long term, and etc. As an example, consider the case of Waco Dam in this figure in the right. Waco Dam embankment and lesson learned from that experience. In October 1961, the construction of Waco Dam was interpreted by the occurrence of a slide along 450 meter section of the embankment. in the downstream here, in this part, resting this embankment resting on paper shield formation, a heavily over consolidated stiff featured clay. Over consolidated stiff featured clay, a photograph of the 25 meter high embankment taken shortly after the slide occurred. This photo taken after the failure or the slide occurred. In the slide region, the paper shale had been geologically uplifted to the surface and was pounded laterally by two faults crossing the axis of the embankment. There are two faults crossing the axis in the back in the boundary of this zone of failure. The slide was confined to the length of the embankment found in paper shale and no significant movement were observed point the fault boundary. The other example here, in August 1970, during construction of a new shipping terminal at the port of San Francisco, long portion of an water slope about 27 meter high filled with the soil on the one side sliding into the trench. In this location, the engineer used slope 1-to-1, one horizontal to one vertical. But after some tests and some recommendation, they used and to minimize the cost of the cut in the San Francisco Bay mud, they used the slope with 0.875 horizontal to one vertical. This is a steep slope. Okay, considerable experience in the San Francisco Bay Area had led to the widely followed practice of excavating underwater slope in and an inclination of one horizontal to one vertical. It means that angle of 45 degree. And this new chipping terminal, however, it was desired to make slopes steeper, if possible, to reduce the volume of cut and fill needed for the stability trench and therefore to reduce the cost of the project. What the result? The result, the failure occurred. As you see, this is the design and this is the field surface. All of this soon moved into the bottom of that canal and caused the failure and the volume of the canal was affected. Laboratory test, we need to know the reason for this failure. Laboratory tests on the best obtainable similar and extensive analysis of stability lead to the conclusion that it would be possible to excavate the slopes 2.871 horizontal to one vertical. At this inclination, the computed factor of safety of a slope would be 1.17. What is the result? The result was a failure depicted in figure. An investigation after the failure led to the conclusion that the strength of the pay mud, this pit mud that could be mobilized in the field, over a period of several weeks was lower than the strength measured in laboratory test. This is very important thing. We shall think about the strength parameter we will use in the analysis of the slope stability, because these parameters can be changed in the long term or after some months, because climate change, drying, wetting condition, and etc. Lower than the strength, lower than in the laboratory test in which the biomat was loaded to failure in a few minutes. And that's the cause of the difference with creep strength loss. Creep strength loss, according to Duncan and Benchiginani at 1973. Introduction slope in rocks and soil. We will summary the introduction slope in rock and soil in the following or the next section. Number one, we learn our most important lesson from experience. Often from experience involving failures, the state of the art is advanced through these failures. We shall improve our knowledge after these failures and lessons they teach. As a result, the method we use depends strongly on experience. Number two, in spite of the fact that our method may have a logical background in mechanics and our understanding of the behavior of soils and rock, it's important to remember that these methods are still semi-empirical. Okay. Number three, we shouldn't expect that we have no more lessons to learn. As conditions arise that are different from the condition on which our experience is based, we may find that our semi-empirical methods are inadequate and need to be changed or expanded. Number four, the lesson learned from that experience is now part of the state of the art, but it would be imprudent to think that the current state of knowledge is complete. The objective of this diploma is to draw together some of lessons that have been learned about measuring soil strength and performing analysis of stability into a consistent, clear, convenient reference for practicing engineers. Scope of the studying slope stability in soil and rock. The design of rock and of rock cuts involves the following item. Number one, collection of geotechnical data. Number two, the use of appropriate design methods. Number three, implementation of excavation method. Number four, stabilization and protection measures suitable for the particular site condition. In order to address all this issue, this diploma is divided into eight distinct modules that cover design data, design methods, and excavation support procedures for rocks and soil. One, design data. Number A, geotechnical data, of which structural geology in strong rock is usually the most important. This information includes the orientation of discontinuities and their characteristics such as length, spacing, roughness, and infilling. Number B, rock strength, with the most important parameters being the shear strength. Slope condition may include discontinuous surfaces in strong rock or rock mass with either very closely spaced discontinuities or in weathered rock where individual discontinuities don't control stability. Number C, groundwater condition, compressed groundwater level within the slope, water pressure that are generated on potential sliding surfaces and protruders to drain the slope if necessary. Number two, design methods. Design methods for rock and slope and soil slopes fall into two groups, either limit equilibrium analysis and or numerical analysis. Limit equilibrium analysis calculates the factor of safety of the slope based on the ratio of the resisting and driving forces. Different limit equilibrium analysis brochures are used for plane, wedge, circular, and tumbling failure, with the type of failure being defined by the structural geology of the slope. Numerical analysis examines the stresses and strains developed in the slope, and stability is assessed by comparing the stresses in the slope with the rock strength. Stabilization and reinforcement. Stabilization methods include rock and soil reinforcement with rock anchors and duels, rock removal involving scaling, trim, blasting, and rock fall protection measures comprising ditches and fences, sheds. Monitoring of slope movement in order to identify acceleration that can be a precursor to failure of the slope. If we want to know the this is a failure will be happening, we shall do monitoring time by time during cutting the slope. to predict if the failure may be happen or not. Monitoring is often an important part of slope management in open pit mines, as well as large slow moving landslides above important infrastructure. Socioeconomic consequences of slope failure. What will be done if the slope will be failed? Failure of rocks and soil slope, both man-made and natural, include rock falls, overall slope instability and landslides, as well as debris flow and shallow landslides in weatherlock. The consequence of such failure can include direct costs or indirect costs. Direct costs such as removing the field rock and stabilizing the slope, and possibly a wide variety of indirect costs. Example of indirect costs include damage to vehicles and energy to passengers on highways and railways, traffic delays, business disruptions, loss of tax revenue due to the decreased land values, and flooding and disruption to water supplies where rivers are blocked by slides. The cost of slope failure is greatest in urbanized areas with high population densities, where even small sites may destroy houses and block transportation routes. In contrast, slides in rural areas may have few indirect costs, except perhaps the cost due to the loss of agriculture land. Example of slope failure in soils. National Highway number 3 landslide in Taiwan. On April 2010, fast moving landslides, as you see in the picture here, with a volume of about 260,000 yards, occurred on a hill slide above National Highway number 3 in Taiwan. The sliding mass bared 4 cars on the freeway and caused 5 deaths. This is a mistake in spelling, 5 deaths. The slide occurred on a steep dip slope that had been supported by 572 ground anchor, each one pre-stressed to 133 kilopounds. Investigation of the failure concluded that the slide was caused by even with the loss of all of the stabilizing forces provided by the anchor, the hill slide would still have been stable unless the strengths of the sandstone and shale were also reduced by softening or by poor water pressures that were higher than considered in design. This means that if all of the anchor failed or corroded, the slope can stay stable, but the main reason for the failure is the reduction and reduced the stiffness of the soil by softening or increasing the shear stress by increasing the pore water pressure on the slope. Causes of slope failure. The occurrence of instability in slopes for two reasons. The first reason, for purposes of design and construction new slopes, it's important to be able to anticipate the changes in the properties of soil within the slope that may occur over time. So we must take into the long-term shear strength parameter into consideration and the creep, and we shall put the creep criteria in our vision when we design for the long term, and the various loading and seepage condition to which the slope will subject over the course of its life. Second, for purpose of repairing field slopes, it's important to understand the essential elements of the situation that lead to its failure so that repetition of the failure can be avoided. In discussing the various causes of slope failure, it's useful to begin by considering the fundamental requirement of stability of slopes. It is that the shear strength of the soil must be greater than the shear stress required for equilibrium. This condition can be reached in two ways: through decreased in the shear strength of the soil. Number two, through an increased in shear stress required for equilibrium. Principles of rock slope engineering deformation. For rock slope design, figure below shows the result of surveys of the slope height and angle and stability condition for natural engineered slope. In this two figure, as well as open pit mine slopes, the plots show that many slopes are unstable at flatter angles. Like 20, 25, 30 degrees, 10 degrees, they are unstable for at flatter angle and lower heights than maximum stable values, because weak rock or adverse structure can result in instability, even low slopes at shallow angle. Importantly, the plots also show that no relationship exists between the stable slope height and face angle, and that every slope must be evaluated on its own merits. So this is not a unique rule that we can use, there is no relation between the slope face and the slope height, and every soil type has its own characteristics and had its own behavior in the slope stability analysis. Structural geology of controlled stability. The design of rock cuts is usually concerned with details of the structural geology, the orientation and the characteristics such as continuous lengths, roughness and infilling material of the joints, bedding and faults that occur behind the rock face. Figure in the right shows a cut slope in a shell containing smooth bedding plan, as we see here. This is a smooth bedding plan that are continuous over the full height of the cut and dip at an angle of about 50 degrees toward the highway. Since the friction angle of these discontinuities is about 20 to 25 degrees, any attempt to exaggerate this cut at a steeper angle than the dip of the beds would result in blocks of rock sliding from the face on the beds. The steepest unsupported cut can be made is equal to the dip of the beds. So in some cases, if we need to make the slope more steeper than its stability, the fail will be occurred. Structural geology control of stability. Intact rock strengths, which used indirectly in slope design, related to shear strength, rock masses, roughness, discontinuities, as well as excavation method and costs. In this figure, shows a range of geological condition and their influence on stability, and illustrates the types of information that are important to design. Like in figure number A, potentially unstable discontinuities in phase, potentially unstable because that the angle of the planes or the joints parallel to the angle of the block of the rock that will be fold. Okay, number B, stable slopes. Why this stable slope? Because the joints and plan, the joint plans or the failure plan, the joint plans inside the rock is parallel to the face سلوب انجل سو ستيبل سلوبس فيز اكزاجيفيتد بارلل تو ديسكونتينيوتيز. اوكي نمبر سي ستيبل سلوب مين ديسكونتينيوتيز ديب انتو فيز. مين ديسكونتينيوتي از ديب انتو فيز نورمال تو ذا فيز اند ذير از مينور ديسكونتينيوتي ان ذا اذر دايركشن. النمبر دي بات ان فيجر سي مي بي سم مينور فيلير اكيورد ان سم ماسز اوف ذا روك ان ات سم هايت اف ذا direction of the discontinuity will be perpendicular to the face angle. Number D, toppling failure, example of toppling failure on thin beds, dibbling stably into face. Number E, there are horizontally bedded sedimentary formation, weathering of shale, undercuts strong sandstone beds to form overhang. This is a overhang, so the upper part of the rock above the horizontal discontinuities will be filled from the top to the bottom. Number F, circular failure inclusively fracture weak rock or weathered rock. Slope features and definition. In this figure, we will discuss the slope feature and definition. Example of rock cut geometry, two pinch drill and blast excavation with shallow layer of soil along the crest and a pinch at the top of the rock to contain soil sloughing. This is a typical section of the slope. The first upper part is a soil, so with a flatter slope here. Soil overburden face angle here is flatter. Then it's a pinch and at the top level of the rock for maintenance purposes. And then we can cut the slope into two levels or three levels, five levels, according to the height we need. Then we can, after one step drill offset, this offset can use for maintenance and the minimum of this offset will be discussed here. Here we figure shows a cut in strong rock requiring drilling and blasting for excavation with soil overburden at the crest, that is a cut at a stable angle. In addition, a pinch is excavated at the top of rock to contain minor sloughing of the soil over time. It is also helpful if access to the pinch for maintenance equipment is available. Cuts excavated by drilled and blast method in strong rock are usually made in series of horizontal slices or lifts, like here, this is a lift and this is a second lift, that have vertical heights for civil projects. The height of each step ranges between 6 to 10 meters. The offset between the cut faces is either wide enough to contain rock falls and provide access for excavating equipment. The recommended offset width is 5 meter. Then we will move to rock slope design method, the design method of rock slope. Based upon these concepts of slope stability, the stability of a slope can be expressed in one or more of the following terms. Number one, factor of safety, stability quantified by the factor of safety, that is the ratio of the submission of the resisting forces to deriving forces, termed limit equilibrium of the slope, which is stable if factor of safety is more than one. Allowable strain, another method, field defined by onset of strain, one set of strain, great enough to prevent safe operation of the slope. Acceptable strain values depend on the applications, such as foundation of bridge or for bridges or building that have a low tolerance for movement. Number three of the method of rock slope design, probability of failure, stability quantified by probability distribution of difference between resisting and displacing forces, margin of safety, which are each expressed as probability distribution. Number four, load and resistance factor design, لل RFD method stability defined by the factored resistance being greater than or equal to the summation of the factored load. Limit equilibrium method, one of the design method mentioned before, is the limit equilibrium method that used the factor safety method for slope design as shown. For all shear type failures, the rock can be assumed to be a Morcone criteria, Morcone material, in which the shear strength is expressed in terms of cohesion, C and friction angle alpha, phi, for a sliding surface on which the effective normal stresses is acting. The shear strength tau developed in this developed on this surface is given pi, tau be equal to C plus overburden effective pressure multiplied by tan phi. This is a more quorum criteria for the shear strength. Factor of safety here is tau divided by tau s. Tau is the shear strength, and the tau is the shear stress applied on the soil. Limit equilibrium method, calculation of the factor of safety for block shown in figure below, involves resolution of the force acting on the sliding surface into components acting perpendicular, like you see, this is the weight of the slope want to be moved. The perpendicular portion is a W multiplied by cosine psi p, where is the psi p is the angle of the slip surface, and the parallel portion is W multiplied by sine psi p. Okay, the W sine B want to let the slope in staple, and the normal or perpendicular portion of the W cosine psi B want will lead to friction force here that prevent this mass to slip. Okay. The depth of the sliding surface is psi b, the area is A, and the weight of the block lying above the sliding surface is W, the weight of the block, the block of soil above the slip surface plan. The normal and shear stresses on the sliding are normal stresses W cosine psi divided by area, because W cosine b is the normal force divided by area result the normal stresses, and shear stresses W sine psi b multiply divided by the area. So that add the shear strength according to more Coulomb criteria or more Coulomb equation equal to C plus normal stresses multiply in multiplying tan phi, the normal stresses. This is the normal stresses here. This is the normal stresses coming from this equation, multiplied by tan phi, so the shear strength is known now. Then we can get the shear stresses. The shear stresses multiplying by area equal to weight multiplying by sine psi b. So we can get the factor of safety finally, dividing the shear strength of the soil divided by the shear stress of the soil, and the factor of safety can be get from this equation, C multiplied by A Z plus weight multiplied cosine psi B in tan phi divided by W sine psi B. This is the shear stress, and this is the shear strength. If this factor of safety more than one, then this slope will be safe and stable. The resisting stresses exceeded the displacing stresses if tau more than tau s, so the factor of safety is greater than one and the slope is stable. Continuing. In the limit equilibrium, if the sliding surface is clean and continuous no filling, if this sliding is clean, no cohesion, okay, Then the cohesion is likely to be zero. C is to be zero. And factor of safety will be factor of safety multiplying sine psi beta over cosine psi beta بيساوي tan phi. Factor of safety here. Factor of safety here can be calculated. Factor of safety be tan phi over tan psi b sine over cosine can get tan psi b. This is a simplest equation. If the phi is all infinity slope, we can get the factor of safety by this equation tan phi divided by tan psi b. Where is the tan psi b? Where is the psi b? Is the slip surface plane angle. That is, the block is at a condition of limit equilibrium when driving forces are exactly equal to the resisting forces and the factor of safety is equal one. Therefore, the method of slope stability analysis described in this section is termed limit equilibrium analysis. Site investigation and geological data collection in soil. This is related to module number two. Site investigation and geological data collection in soils and rock. The design of rock cuts is often an iterative process. Iterative process that proceeds with from initial reconnaissance through preliminary and finally design followed by construction. This process involves progressively collecting more detailed design data specific to the site condition and needs of the project. Typically, the three stage of a complete investigation are as follows. Recognizance divided into five subsections. Number one, examination of published geological maps and reports. Number two, study of air photographs. Number three, gathering of local experience. Field visits to examine, if possible, the performance of existing slopes in similar geological condition. Geophysics studies if outcrops are limited. Number two, road selection, preliminary slope design. If the project involves the evaluation of alternative routes, limited investigation could be carried out of each road comprising outcrop mapping, geophysics to field overburden thickness and index tests of rock probability. For acquiring considerable geological information on the probability will usually be generated during the exploration program. This will be often include mapping, geophysics, and drilling from which the geotechnical data can be obtained. It is beneficial to the design of the quarry slopes if geotechnical can be collected as a part of exploration program. Number three, detailed investigation. Detailed mapping of outcrops and exciting cuts to study structural geology. Test pits to obtain information on overburden thickness and probabilities. Diamond drilling to investigate rock condition at depth, core orientation to obtain structural geology information, and installation of piezometers to measure groundwater level and possibly hydraulic conductivity. Rock strength testing could comprise laboratory testing of drill core to determine the friction angle of discontinuities, uniaxial compressive strength, and slick durability. The other section in this module, planning, this is the first planning and investigation program that we talked about in the previous two slides. The second section is site reconnaissance. We talked about something as a little bit about this topic. Then we will talk in the diploma about geological mapping, stereogeometric mapping of discontinuities, types of discontinuity, definition of geological terms, Also, spacing, resistance, and roughness measurement, spacing of discontinuities, resistance of discontinuity sets, roughness of rock surfaces, problemistics analysis of structure geology will be included in this module, module number two, like discontinuity orientation, discontinuity length and spacing, probability distributions of length and spacing, and also investigation of weathered rock. The third module, in the third module, yeah, that's titled Rock Strength Properties, Groundwater and Their Measurement. And like you see in the title of this diploma, we will know about the strength properties of rock, and we will know in details about the groundwater and their measurements. Introduction, scale effect and rock strengths. What is the effect of scale? We will study on the, if we will study slope in the rock. If the project involves the evaluation of alternative routes, limited investigation could be carried out of each route. So for example, in the deep, multi-pinch excavation shown, like shown in this figure. This figure show that idealized diagram showing the transition from intact rock to joint rock mass with increasing sample size. There are five scaling here in this figure. The scale number one, this is a very small scale here in this circle. This is intact rock. If we will zoom in in the rock, and we will study a very small circle, we will find that this is an intact rock. But if we will widen or expand this cycle to let the scale a little bit bigger or more scale, we will find one single joint set. Then in the third, we will two joint sets. In the third, in this two joint, parallel and perpendicular to the slope, or two joints in two directions. The fourth, many joints in this circle, the fourth circle, this circle, many joints. The fifth and the last circle included jointed rock mass. So the scale that we will study is very important, and because we will define the rock according to this scale. For example, in the deep multi-bench excavation shown, the dimension of the overall slope are much greater than the discontinuity spacing. So any failure surface will pass through the jointed rock mass and the appropriate rock strength to use the design of the overall stability slope is that of the rock mass. In this module, we will talking about shear strength discontinuities in 3.2 subheader, and this will contains definition of cohesion and friction, friction angle of rock surface, shearing on an inclined plane, surface roughness, discontinuity in filling, influence of water on shear strength of discontinuities. And then laboratory testing of shear strength for rock, shear strength of rock masses by back analysis of a slope failure. In 3.5, Hoch-Brown strength criterion will be discussed in our diploma for fractured rock mass. In this section, we will talk about generalized Hoch-Brown strength criterion, modulus of deformation, Young's modulus E, more Coulomb criteria, and more Coulomb rock mass strengths, determination of sigma max, sigma 3 lateral earth pressure max, estimation of disturbance factor D, then shear strength of weathered rock mass, rock durability and compressive strength, groundwater in the last subsection. In this module, we will study the hydraulic cycle, hydraulic conductivity, porosity, flow net, And in 3.9, groundwater flow in fractured rock, flow in clean rough discontinuity, flow in field discontinuities, heterogeneous rock, and isotropic rock, groundwater in rock slopes, hydraulic conductivity of weathered rock. Then measurement of water pressure. We will discuss something about measurement of water pressure, field measurement of hydraulic conductivity, variable heat tests or pumping tests to get the coefficient of permeability or coefficient of hydraulic conductivity. In module number three, yes, this slide we're talking about, the scaling that we discussed in the previous slide. The first slide of the third module, and this is contains the discontinuities for the single bedding plan, sin rock mass, sin intact rock, the transition from intact rock to discontinuity or to the joint rock mass. As we discussed before, we will move to module number four, rock slope failure types. Firstly, we will study the plane failure, including introduction, general condition for plane failure analysis, deep slope stability, the reinforcement of slope, probabilistics analysis, design in plane failure. The second failure type of rock is wedge failure. And we will discuss introduction, definition of wedge geometry, analysis of wedge failure, analysis, design of wedge, including cohesion, friction, and water pressure, with wedge stability charts for friction only, comprehensive wedge analysis. We will talk more information about plan failure and wedge failure in the next slides. For the plan failure, as you see in this photo, plan failure on smooth resistance bedding plans in shale. The plan failure is particularly useful for demonstrating the sensitivity of the slope to changes in shear strength and groundwater condition, which are less obvious when dealing with more complex mechanics of three-dimensional slope failure, because this failure is a simple failure of type, because it's a planar failure that occurred in one plan. Figure shows a typical plan failure in a rock slope where a block of rock has slide on a single plan dipping out of the face. This is one of the, this is an illustration figures for the plane failure. Geometrical condition for plane failure as shown in the figure A. This is the face angle and the planar angle failure. Psi F is the face angle. Psi B is the plane failure angle, and phi is the internal friction angle of the rock, of the soil. So as we saw, here, the plane failure angle will be less than the face angle and more than the internal friction angle. And this is the 3D, and the plane failure contain two release surfaces, the shear strength in those surfaces becomes zero, and the plane failure slide plane will occur here, and two release surfaces shall be included in the plane failure. In plane in which sliding occurs must strike parallel or nearly parallel within approximately plus minus 20 degrees to the slope face. The sliding plane must be in the slope, which means that the depth of the plane must be less than the depth of the slope face. As I talked before, the psi p, the plane failure angle plane, the plane failure angle will be higher than, less than the face angle. The depth of the sliding plane must be greater than the angle of friction of this plane. This is a must to the failure occurred, that the plane failure angle must be greater than the internal friction angle of the plane. The upper end of the sliding surface either intersects the upper slope or terminated in a tension crack like we see here. The upper end of the sliding surface either intersect with the upper slope, either intersect the upper slope here, or if there is a tension crack, we will intersect with the tension crack here. Release surfaces that provide negligible resistance to sliding must be present in the rock mass to define lateral boundaries of the slide. Alternatively, failure can occur on a sliding plane passing through the convex of a slope in the top of the slope. The second type of failure of rock, wedge failure, as we see in this photo, this is a clear wedge failure, like you see. Two plane. And this is the wedge failure occurred that consists of two plane failure combined together, and the mass of the rock inside two planes will be moved and failure as a wedge failure type. Typical wedge failure involving sliding two resistance joints with line of intersection. This is the line of the intersection. Line of intersection of the two jointed planes. At toe of the rock face and an upper plane that formed tension crack. This part is concerned with the failure of slope containing discontinuities trickling obliquely to the slope face, where sliding of wedge of rock takes place along the line of the intersection of two such planes. Wedge failure can occur over a much wider range of geological and geometric condition than plane failure. Therefore, the study of the wedge stability is an important component of rock slopes engineering. The third, this is a geometrical condition for wedge failure. Like you see, this is the components of the wedge failure: face, wedge. This is a wedge, line of intersect of the two joint planes. And this is a section. This is the line. This is the face angle, the psi f. And this is the wedge plane failure perpendicular to the intersect line. And the final one is the internal friction angle of the wedge failure plane. Based on this geometry and figure, the general condition for wedge failure as follow. Two planes will always intersect in a line. On the strongest, the line of intersection is represented by points where the two grid circles of planes intersect, and the orientation of the line is divided by its trend and its blank. There are two planes or two circles of failure, this plane E and plane P, and the soil inside to this plan will be failed in a wedge failure type. We can move to the third type of failure in rock, circular failure. It also necessary to design cuts in weak material. If the rock will be weak rock or weathered rock, it's necessary to design cut in weak material such as highly weathered or closely fractured rock and rock fills. In such material, failure occurs along surface that approaches a circular shape shown in figure. Like you see, this failure is failure on a slip, circular slip surface. This may be weathered rock or rock fill. Okay. Condition for circular failure and method of analysis. The condition under which circular failure will occur arises when the individual particles in a soil or rock mass are very small, very small, the particle size of the soil or rock, very small compared with the size of the slope. Broken rock in a fall will tend to behave as a soil and fail in a circular mode when the slope dimensions are substantially greater than the dimension of the rock fragments. Similarly, soil consisting of sand, silt, and smaller particle size will exhibit circular slide surfaces even in slopes only a few meters in height. Okay, if the height of the slope is very little, the circular failure may be occurred. Highly altered and weathered rocks, as well as rock with closely spaced, randomly oriented discontinuities, such as some rapidly cooled basalts, will also tend to fail in this manner. This manner, this circular manner, it is appropriate to design slopes in these materials on the assumption that a circular failure process will develop. Toppling blocks, toppling failure is the fourth type of failure of rock, as you see in the figure in the right. Toppling blocks in columnar basalt, in columnar basalt showing typical tension cracks with widths greater at the top and narrowing near the base. Like you see, this is a toppling. The spacing in the top is very near. So choosing a typical tension width greater in the top and this width is smaller in the bottom. This part will discuss different failure mode that of toppling, which involves rotation of this part when the center of mass of this rock will make an eccentricity with the center of the base. This rock will be fold in the manner of the toppling failure type. Okay. Figure show typical toppling blocks in columnar basalt. Types of toppling failure will be discussed in details in this part in our diploma. One example of the toppling mechanism is illustrated in figure. In an open pit mines where the depth of the slope progressively increases, minor toppling movement may eventually develop into a substantial failure. Careful monitoring of the movement and recognitions of the toppling mechanism can be used to anticipate when hazardous conditions are developed. This is the steps that the toppling failure created from the initiation to the failure here in this figure. Module number five, we will discuss numerical analysis and software application in rock slope. In the introduction, we will discuss factor of safety determination, comparison of numerical limit equilibrium analysis method, typical results, limit equilibrium methods. Again, we will see that assume rigid perfectly plastic material behavior and are therefore incapable of computing displacement or deformation. So one is the disadvantage of this type of analysis that the LEM method, limit equilibrium method, can't compute strains or stresses, displacements or deformation, can compute deformation or strains in the problem. By contrast, numerical models, sometimes called deformation models or displacement methods, are capable of computing displacements and deformation and can use a variety of material models to simulate rock slope behavior. Numerical methods are more recent developments than limit equilibrium method, and their use has increased significantly since 2005, in part due to increased computer speed, but also due to more general acceptance by practitioners. Numerical analysis. The reason why numerical models are used for slope stability studies. One of the reasons, the first one, numerical models can be extrapolated confidently outside their databases in comparison to empirical method in which the failure mode is explicitly defined. In the numerical, the failure of the slip surface will be a result, not assumption in the first of the problem. We will build the model, the numerical model, and after running the analysis, the location and the shape of the failure surface will be appeared, and we will be one of the result of the analysis, not choosing from the beginning of the model. Number two, numerical analysis can incorporate key geologic features such as faults. We can modify faults, groundwater, providing more realistic approximation of the behavior of real slope than analytic models, because the analytic models make the model more simple and not more accurate or realistic. In comparison, non-numerical analysis methods such as analytic, physical, or limit equilibrium may be unsuitable for some site or complex example, or tend to oversimplify the condition. Oversimplify the condition, the limit equilibrium or the analytic physical model let the problem more simple and possibly leading to overly conservative solution. And this will lead to over design and cost more for the construction. Numerical analysis can help to explain observed physical behavior. Number four, numerical analysis can evaluate multiple possibilities of geological models and failure. Comparison of numerical and limit equilibrium analysis method. The shear strength reduction technique that used in numerical analysis has two main advantages over limit equilibrium method. Slope stability in the slope stability analysis. First, the critical slide surface is found automatically, as I discussed a few minutes before, and it's not necessary to specify the shape of the slide surfaces. Like circular, log spiral, piecewise, linear, etc. in advance. In general, the failure surface geometry for slope is more complex than simple circular or segmented surface. The second one, or the second advantages of the numerical models, automatically satisfy translational and rotational equilibrium, whereas not all limit equilibrium method do satisfy equilibrium. Consequently, the shear strength reduction technique usually will determine a factor of safety equal to or slightly less than limit equilibrium method for similar failure modes. A summary of the differences between numerical solution and the limit equilibrium will shown in the next table. As you see in this table, the comparison item is the analysis result, equilibrium, stresses, deformation, failure, kinematics between the numerical solution and the limit equilibrium solution. For equilibrium, numerical solution satisfied everywhere. For limit equilibrium, satisfied only for specific objects such as slices, not for all shapes. Stresses in numerical solution computed everywhere using field equation, computed approximately on a certain surfaces. We must we must select limited or specific surfaces to get the stresses. Deformation in numerical analysis part of the solution, but in no limit equilibrium not considered. Failure, yield conditions satisfied everywhere. Slide surfaces developed automatically as condition indicated. But in limit equilibrium, failure allowed only on certain predefined surfaces, not check on yield condition elsewhere. In kinematics, the mechanisms that develop satisfy kinematic constraint, but in limit equilibrium, a single kinematic condition is specified according to the particular geologic condition. Then we will discuss more details about numerical analysis in our diploma. In section 5.2 overview of numerical models contains discontinuum and continuum models, analysis methods, rock mass material models, rock mass material models, isotropic material, anisotropic material, joint material models. In the next section, modeling consideration, two-dimensional versus three-dimensional modeling, boundary location, initial condition, discretization, incorporating water pressure, simple stability analysis in section 5.4, rock mass failure, plane failure, wedge failure, toppling failure, complex kinematics, and in the next section, application of software in the design and analysis of slew failures in rock. We will use Rockfall, one of the software for rock science company, and rock plane, sewage. Rock science is also rock science package. Slide 2D, rock science package, limit equilibrium analysis to get safety factor. Praxis 2D or 3D using strength reduction method finite element. We will use, I think we will use Praxis 2D and using strength reduction methods like finite element method. And we will finally make comparison between limit equilibrium and finite element method. In module number 6, we will study slope stability analysis in soil, introduction, drained and undrained condition. In order for slope stability analysis to be useful, they must represent the correct problem correctly formulated. This requires mastery or knowledge, high knowledge of the principle of soil mechanics, knowledge of geology and site condition, knowledge of the property of soils at the site. This part will deal with the principle of soil mechanics that are needed to understand and to formulate analysis of slope stability problem collectively. The definition used in soil mechanics are related to the ease and speed with which water can move in or out of the soil in comparison with the length of time involved in loading and unloading of the soil. The section 6.2, we will study total and effective stress, then drained and drained shear strength, source of shear strength, drained strength, volume change during drained shear, pore water pressure changing during undrained shear, undrained strength envelopes. Then move to basic requirements for slope stability analysis, included analysis of drained condition, analysis of undrained, how long does drainage take, short-term analysis, long-term analysis, and progressive failure. Stability condition for analysis in section 6.5 include introduction, end of construction stability, long-term stability, rapid drawdown, sudden drawdown, and in case of earthquake analysis, earthquake load, how we can include the earthquake in the analysis, partially consolidation and stage construction, other loading condition. Then analysis cases of four earth and rock fill dams. Mechanics of limit equilibrium protruders contains definition of the factor of safety, equilibrium condition, single free body protruders, protruders of slices, circular slip surface. Then in 6.8, pore water pressure representation, flow net solution, numerical solution, interpolation schemes, phreatic surface, piezometric line, examples and summary. Then slope stability analysis using limit equilibrium method and finite element method in soil. Software application slide. I think we will use slide 2D and Praxis 2D. Slide 2D for limit equilibrium method analysis and Praxis 2D for shear strength reduction analysis method using finite element method. In module number 7, we will talk about rock and soil reinforcement stabilization. Module number 7 contains rock stabilization by reinforcement. Like you see in this figure contains rock slope stab reinforcement method from number 1 to number 6. Number 1, simulate reinforced concrete shear K. This is a shear K. To prevent loosening of slab to crest, to prevent loosening in this in the top of the rock. Number two, tension the rock anchor to secure sliding block along crest. Tension anchor, like you see, this is anchor divided two parts, bonded part and free part. The length of bonded is LP and LF for the free. Number three, tied back wool, park with anchor, tied back wool with anchor or with rock bolts to prevent sliding on fault zone. This is a fault zone. So this fault zone need a wool to prevent this zone to fail. And for the number four, shotcrete for the facing to prevent of the zone of fracture rock. If this is a fracture rock, we can use shotcrete on the facing with 100 millimeter on 150 millimeter to prevent any local failure in the weathered rock or fracture rock in this zone. Number five, drain hole. This drain hole tube to release the pore water pressure if any sources of water comes to the behind of the sloop. Number six, concrete patterns to support rock above cavity. Concrete patterns to support rock above cavity. Number two, stabilization by rock removal. Like this. Rock removal method for slope stabilization is one type of the rock stabilization. There are many types of stabilization by rock removal, like the re-sloping and unloading, like in the first thing, re-sloping of unstable weathered material in the upper part. We can excavate this part to re-slope the rock and let it more stable. Number two, trimming axis. After cutting this area, we can make an axis bench of the top cut. Remove of rock by trimming blasting. This is the second method, trimming blasting for this area. Then scaling, removal of trees with roots ground of rock. Hand scaling of loose blocks in shattered rock by hand, we can overcome these instability zones. And number four, rock removal operations. Rock removal operation. Stabilization of rock slopes can be accomplished by removal of the potentially unstable rock, like shown in figure. There are three types, as we discussed. The third type of reinforcement protection measures against rock fall. We can make a rock fall modeling using rock fall software. And like you see, you can get the height of the mass falling rock and the distance that we will there's something in sharing. Everyone see my screen? Okay. Now everyone see my screen? All is okay? Student, you can't see my screen? Yeah, thank you. We can make a rock fall modeling and estimate the height of the rock that will be fold, the height of the piece of rock, and the distance that will be on after modeling. After that, ditches, we can use ditches to collect the rock masses, falls from a height, like this. This is design chart for rockfall catchment. We can use fence, or if the block, if the rock will move from this fence, we will move the towards the bottom of the slope, and we can use ditches here to collect this rock masses like this. And we shall design the height and the length and width of this ditch based on the analysis of the rockfall design. The third barriers like this. This is a barrier of fences with the M.Sc. wall and strengthening by wire rope fence, by a wire rope. And if any rock fold from the top of the slope, we can collect it in this, and the impact force will be loaded on the fence and the MSEW wall and other rock catch fences and attenuators, the draped meshes and warning fences can be used for protection measure against rock falls and rock sheds. Then we will move to reinforced slope for soil and embankment. We will discuss limit equilibrium analysis with reinforcing forces, factor of safety for reinforcing forces and soil strengthening, types of reinforcement forces, allowable reinforcement forces and factor of safety, orientation of reinforcement forces, reinforced slope on firm foundation as an example, and embankments on weak foundation. Reinforcement can be used to improve the stability of slopes and embankments, making it possible to construct slopes and embankments steeper and higher than would otherwise be possible. If we need to construct a steep embankment with degree like 70 degree, we can do that with using some reinforcement material that will put vertically spacing to strengthen the slope and to make it stable. Reinforced slope and embankment. The reinforcement has been used in four distinct types of application. The first one, reinforced soil slope. Multiple layers of reinforcement are installed within fill slopes at vertical spacing that are calculated during design, as I drawn before. The second, reinforcement embankment in weak foundation. A weak foundation, like we have an embankment here, and the soil behind this embankment is weak soil. So if we want to strengthen and reduce the settlement below, beneath the this embankment, we can use reinforcement layer here. This layer will be reduce the settlement and increase the shear strength and the peak capacity beneath the embankment. Mechanically stabilized earth wall and modular block, this type of structure using for retaining as a retaining structure. If we want to retain soil, we can use MSEW that contains of geosynthetics or steel strips reinforcement material placed in vertical spaced layers like 60 centimeter, 40 centimeter. Depend on the type of the reinforcement and the height of the wall. The fourth is anchored wall, vertical soldier piles or slally trenches, concrete can be tie packed or anchored at one or more levels to provide support of excavation. If we will use the sheet pile wall or secant pile wall is between two levels, and we will excavate this part. If the height of the excavation is more higher, 6, 9, 10 meter, we can use tie packs, anchor with bounded and free length here, two level or three level, as we will see regarding to the soil type and the height of the excavation. And finally, module number 8, we will, the student will receive a project thesis, and we will define the lines, review the preliminary thesis project, and review the draft thesis.